You ever hear of Jay Paul? Oh, damn. All right, hold up. So in 2010, 2011, this singer-songwriter producer from London releases his demo track on MySpace. It's called BTSTU. I don't know what it means. Don't ask me. And at the time, this was some cutting-edge stuff. It was dubstep and indie rock and R&B, like all in one song, and it just worked. He was taking a lot of elements from various scenes and putting them all into one accessible pop song. I mean, you really had to hear this thing in 2011 to get it, but it just sounded like this is what the future of music is gonna sound like, you know? Anyways, it blows up and music blogs begin to write good things, gets called best new track and whatnot. UK radio stations start throwing it into rotation. Then record labels catch wind of his single and start a bidding war to sign this guy. He eventually signs to the same label as Adele, I think Vampire Weekend at the time, Radiohead. Like, things are happening for this kid. And as if that wasn't enough, Drake drops a track that samples his song.
I got car money, fresh start money, I want Saudi money, I want art money.
Beyonce drops a track that samples the song. Yeah, it was a huge deal for someone coming out of the indie scene. And not even a year later, Jay drops another demo called Jasmine. And by now, people are calling this guy the second coming of Prince, like, musically. There are artists that put out 5, 6, 7, 10 albums with no cultural impact, and then there's Jay Paul who does it in 2 songs. These tracks went on to influence James Blake, Frank Ocean, I think Lorde and Brockhampton have straight up said they were influenced by Jay, and after him we started seeing a lot more R&B mixed with minimal electronics. He inspired an entire wave of underground artists, they literally called it J-Wave. But most of it was the Jay Paul sound minus the Jay Paul mind, you know, just it wasn't the same. Jay's songs are bursting with creativity and passion and just an insane amount of attention to detail. I have no idea where he comes up with the sonic choices he makes. Anyways, what was I saying? He's making some pretty big waves in the industry at this point, and people still don't know a thing about him. All we knew was that he was working on his debut album, and I think he produced a song for Big Boy, one of the guys from Outkast, and then things just went quiet for a bit. Then bam, April 2013, his album goes up on Bandcamp, but with no name and everything's untitled. The internet hears Jasmine and BTSTU and figures out that this is Jay Paul's music, like this is the album. And they're linking everyone over to it because hype, you know, like the thing's finally here. Everyone thinks it's a surprise drop because there was no publicity or anything leading up to it. But it's weird, because like there was a ton of anticipation for his album, and unexpectedly dropping it on a Saturday night just didn't make sense. His label starts denying the release, pretty much saying they didn't authorize this thing to go on sale, much less for it to be released. So what happened? The guy's laptop got stolen. Yeah, and whoever had it uploaded his unfinished album online. People started thinking it was just a marketing plan and that Jay uploaded it himself, but I don't know. Why would the label or him upload an unfinished album? Like, the mixing on some tracks were garbage. It just wasn't the polished sound we came to expect from the guy. And what's hilarious, though, is that despite it being unfinished, this album has been critically acclaimed and hyped up to legendary levels. It made end-of-year lists. It was like Justin Timberlake, Justice, and James Blake had an experimental electronic R&B baby. It was absolutely insane stuff when you think about the contemporary R&B that was coming out at the time. You had like The Dream, Neo, Lloyd were dropping pretty good but stagnated R&B. It was just really refreshing to hear something somewhat experimental yet accessible. Again, it was pretty rough and the mixing was crap, but the beats and the production on this thing were so forward-thinking and just the ideas he had going on this album were creative enough for people to be blown away. And that rawness only added to the project. The blaring synths, the crunchy drums, the compressed audio, it all feels so dramatic and colorful while still being stripped back. The vocals are smooth, they hit the right emotional beats. The whole thing wears its flaws so well and just makes me think he was constantly tinkering away with his music. You gotta listen to some of this stuff on headphones. even unfinished, his tracks are just painstakingly crafted. People were dying for this guy's debut album, and in 2013, they got it. It's just unfortunate that it was an early leak of demos. Some tracks were probably never even meant to be heard. Pretty much all of his work from 2007 to 2013 was leaked. It's got to be crushing to have 6 years of your creative work unwillingly released to the world when it's not where you want it to be. It sucks. He was robbed of his stardom. All at once, he failed to arrive in the industry and made a legacy. And J. Paul was his worst critic. Despite all the praise, he hated that his music was being heard. The songs were dead to him now, and he'd never bring himself to finish the album. The whole thing threw him into a depression, and he pretty much went underground. That was until a few days ago. It's been another 6 years, and he just put out two new songs. And officially released the leaked material from 2013. He still hasn't finished the songs, but he made a few minor changes and the mixing is much cleaner. I think this was his way of reclaiming what was stolen from him. It seems like he's finally embracing those tracks and putting an end to an era so he can move forward. He's ending the conversation so he can start a new one. I'm just happy I can listen to it on Spotify now. So now I'm just waiting for whatever Paul has up his sleeve. That 2013 leak is one of my favorite albums of the decade. Like, I haven't stopped listening to the leak since it leaked. It's my holy grail of music. A compilation that feels more than a project, but a key moment in indie music history. And much like his 0413 leak, J. Paul's story isn't finished. It's magic. You see the It Chapter 2 trailer? Right? You know Stephen King wrote that book, like, on cocaine? There was a good period of time in his life where he was sober for maybe 3 hours out of his day. The guy doesn't even remember writing it. Apparently the book is even more out there than the movie. You ever read it? Yeah, I know, it's long. You should try the audiobook version. There's no better place to start listening than Audible. You can get the audiobook for free when you head to audible.com/middle8 or text middle8 to 500-500 to begin your 30-day free trial. And check this out. There's also an app, so you can access Audible at any time. The gym, in the car, on the go. Audible delivers bestsellers, business, self-improvement, memoirs, and a lot more, all professionally narrated by actors and authors. And if that's not your thing, they've got hundreds of audio-guided fitness and meditation programs. Looking for your favorite morning paper? It's delivered daily to the app. They also offer free and easy audiobook exchanges, so if you don't like one title, you can return it for another. And even if you cancel, your library is yours. Start listening with a 30-day free trial. You'll get your first audiobook as well as two other Audible originals absolutely free when you sign up at audible.com/middle8 or by texting middle8 to 500-500. Thanks for listening. If you enjoyed the video, throw it a like rating. Subscribe to hear more stories behind the music you love. Thank you to my patrons who continue to support this channel. They get a sneak peek at new videos before they're up. And tell me, what do you guys think of J. Paul, his story, and his return to music? Let me know in the comments below. And that's it for me. Again, thanks for watching, and keep listening.